Okay, so let me then introduce today's speaker. Today's speaker is Kirstin Baer, and she is a PhD candidate at the University of Leibniz, Hanover. Our PhD supervisor is Tobias Osborne, and Kirstin Baer is a leading expert on quantum machine learning. Her recent paper, Training Deep Quantum Neural Networks, has over 40,000 accesses at Nature Communications, so it's a true pleasure to have her here with us today to talk about that paper. Thank you very much for joining us, Kirstin.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction and the invitation. I will share my screen. Okay. So welcome to my talk. So today I will talk about training deep quantum neural networks. And yeah, I will basically explain the QNN architecture we worked on in the past years. And I will also give a brief introduction to classical supervised machine learning first. So this will help to understand the QNN algorithm setting. And yeah, after that, I will then explain our architecture and also show some numerical results. And yes, then I will continue with implementation on a NISQ device. So that's also something we worked recently at. And then if we have some time left, I will discuss how to include graph-structured quantum data, because that's something I'm really interested in, and I hope you too. So yeah, let's start then. So first of all, why is machine learning on quantum computers interesting? First of all, why should we bother about quantum computers? So, well, I guess this is familiar to you. It is out of question that people are all over the world interested in quantum computers. There are constantly news about new quantum solution comprising more and more qubits and introducing new challenges and opportunities. Big companies like Microsoft, Google, Amazon, putting a lot of money into developing quantum computers. And yeah, but quantum computing is still an early stage technology, but yeah, we expect rapid progress. And we also expect that quantum computers will change some traditional parts of the industry in the coming years. So yeah, it's an exciting topic. And yeah, I think I hardly have to explain that machine learning or artificial intelligence in general is an interesting topic. But yeah, by the way, it's remarkable that despite the global impact of COVID-19, almost half of the artificial intelligence investments have remained unchanged since the pandemic began. And yeah, nearly a third of the organizations plan to increase these investments. So yeah, machine learning is just everywhere, but yeah, why could it be also useful on quantum computers? So first of all, yeah, if you have two so heavily hyped fields, it's just obvious that yeah, the topic is hot. But yeah, we can also find more detailed application examples. For example, if you want to characterize big quantum data sources, you need a large amount of classical computational effort. And yeah, the information required to classically learn and specify a quantum state via tomography scales exponentially with the number of qubits. And the full tomography of complex states is not possible in the moment. Therefore, we have to think about other possibilities to characterize complex quantum data sources. And quantum machine learning, where the quantum device itself learns the quantum data, seems very promising. So as I already said in the beginning, I would like to start with some classical neural networks, because yeah, they were the motivation for our quantum neural network. And yeah, they also give a good understanding of learning algorithms in general. Okay, so to be more precise, we will only need to talk about supervised learning today. So I will remind you of the most standard example, classifying handwritten digits. And yeah, to make a neural network learn these handwritten digits, you need some data. And in this case, the training pairs are the picture and the right digit. A classical neural network is a circuit out of nodes. And yeah, these nodes are connected to each other in different ways. And the information is copied and changed over and over through the network. And yeah, we will not go in detail here because it's not important for my talk. But yeah, if we want to learn it, I can recommend the website of Michael Nielsen, neuralnetworksanddeeplearning.com. And yeah, the only thing we need to know in this moment is that yeah, there are these connections depicted in lines, as lines here between the neurons, and these connections can be modified. The neural network consists of many layers, and we name the first layer the input layer, then we have some hidden layers in between. And yeah, the last layer is the output layer. The basic idea of this neural network is then that the input data is loaded into the network, and then the information propagates to the network layer by layer. The information changes in every action, and all this is much more complicated than here in this simple figure. But yeah, the idea is then at the end, we have some information in the output layer. And then, for example, here we get for the picture, as an input, we get the number 7. And then we can compare the output of our network with the expected outcome, which is 1. And also this comparison can be done in different ways. But yeah, the most important part is that based on the results of the comparison, we then update the network that it does a better job than before. And after many training rounds and with using many of these data pairs, the network should be trained very well. And yeah, you should get the right output for every input, even for unseen inputs. So for inputs, pictures, which are not in the training data set. So a computer which recognizes handwritten digits has not seen all the handwriting of all the people in the world, but it has seen a huge data set and then can generalize. So yeah, this is the basic idea of supervised classical machine learning. And yeah, with this introduction, let's do some quantum stuff. So in the next part of this talk, we will quantize the classical neural network structure. And our aim is to train a quantum neural network, which does an operation not only with the training inputs, but also with unseen data. And this is not very different to our classical machine learning answers. I will present our QNN ansatz following this paper here. The first thing we can say about our ansatz is that we use quantum data and a quantum neural network. So there are other proposals with quantum speedups for machine learning, for classical machine learning, or classical machine learning used to characterize quantum systems. But in our ansatz, both the neural network and the data are quantum. We want to start again with the training data. So in our case now, the training data pairs consist of 2 quantum states. In the algorithm we present in the paper, the input state can be in general a mixed state, and the supervised output state is a pure state. We can think of an uncharacterized quantum device acting on input states and giving us output states. And then our aim would be to simulate this untrusted or uncharacterized device with the help of our quantum neural network. So yeah, of course, the quantum neural network cannot be built in the same way as the classical neural network because, yeah, first of all, cannot copy information as we do with classical bits. Yeah, the no cloning theorem ruins this idea. And therefore, yeah, we have to think about something else. And yeah, in our neural network, our neural network is a special class of quantum circuits, and it is comprised of quantum perceptrons. And the circuits here in the picture are qubits of the circuit. And in every perceptron here, the connecting lines in different colors. Every perceptron is a unitary operation on the qubits on the current layer and one single qubit on the next layer. So for example, in the first layer, we have three perceptrons depicted as three unitaries. And yeah, all these unitaries are three qubit unitaries, two qubits are in the first layer and one qubit out of the second layer. So since these quantum perceptrons are arbitrary unitaries of operators, the perceptrons do not in general commute. So this is indicated in the figure by over and under crossing. And yeah, it's important to have this in mind. So then, in the same way as in the classical neural network, we load the input data state into the neural network. And yeah, we do this by initializing the two first qubits here with the input state. I will use a two-qubit, three-qubit, two-qubit neural network with these one input layer, one output layer, and one hidden layer to explain in detail how the information propagates through our quantum neural network. So here's the input state. The qubits of the states are in the input layer of the QNN. Then we initialize the next layer in the zero state and tensor this layer to the first layer. Then we can apply the first perceptron, which is a unitary acting on three qubits. Two of them are in the input layer and the third is in layer number two. Please notice that that this three-qubit unitary has, of course, be tensored with some identities to have the right dimension. I will not include these identities here in our formulas in the following to have a better overview. But when programming these quantum algorithms, you have to always have to make sure that you have the right dimension. So this is the notation we want to use here. And then we can apply the next perceptrons. And then we have applied three perceptrons on a state, which is the input state tensor to the identity. Then we can use the trace to get rid of the input layer. And doing this when going to the neural network makes the number of needed qubits only scale with the width, not with the length of the network. And this is a very nice feature of our ansatz, and it also explains why our network was called DQNN, dissipative quantum neural network, because we use always these traces. So then our network has three layers. So we initialize the last layer also in zero state, tensored to to the existing state, and then apply the two 4-qubit unitaries. And yeah, at the end, we trace out all the hidden layers, here the one layer, and remain with the output state of the QNN. So after going feed forward to the network, we have the output state. And yeah, I want to mention an interesting fact about this quantum neural network now. So the network output is given by a composition of sequence of a completely positive layer to layer transition maps. So what I mean here is, in other words, every layer can be seen as a completely positive channel defined by this unitaries and the trace. And the input of one of these channels is the output of the channel before. So we can define the neural network as E out from EL to E1. And due to Steinspring theorem, we can create every CPTP map with this kind of network. But yeah, this only as a note. So back to the learning algorithm. In the next step, we have to compare the output of the neural network with the supervised output. And yeah, we need a good function to compare the states. So in general, there's no correct choice, but however, at least if one of the states is pure, which it is in our case, because we work with pure supervised states, the fidelity as a measure has three advantages. So first of all, the fidelity is a good direct generalization of the risk function considered in training classical deep networks. And secondly, the fidelity can be measured using the swap test. Yeah, therefore we decided to go with this training loss here. So we compare using the fidelity, the pure state, the supervised state with the output of the network. And we do that averaging over all the fidelities for all the training inputs. So X is here, or S is the number of training inputs, supervised states. And we call this function here a loss function. It's our training loss. And we use the information this function gives us to train the quantum neural network. But how does this work? So the quantum neural network consists of unitaries. And to train this network, we want to update the unitaries in every training round. So a training round is over when the network has seen all the supervised training pairs and can be then updated. To update the unitaries in a way that optimizes the loss function, we exploit gradient descent by allowing the perceptron unitaries to depend on a parameter S. And epsilon is here the step size. So yeah, then we update the component unit, the component unitaries of the QNN using this update matrix K. And yeah, one can show that K has to be in general out of this form. Eta is here the learning rate, and this M matrix is a commutator. And I will not show you its general formula because it's very ugly and long, but I still explain in our simple network example how this K matrix is built. Okay, to update this unitary marked in red, we do the following. And yeah, notice that all the unitaries here in this formula depend on our step parameter s, but for shorter notation, we will leave it out here. So yeah, we want to update this red perceptron. And the K matrix contains the input state. The input state was propagated forward direction to the network. So we tensored the initialized state from the next layer. Then we apply as many perceptrons as we include the perceptron we want to update. And on the other side of the commutator, we go backwards. So we start with the supervised output state, not with the output state of the network, but the output included in the training data pair. And we start with the supervised output and go backwards to the neural network, so back propagation. And we tensor the initialized preceding layer to the supervised state. And then apply the adjoint channel. You see the daggers in the unitary. So we go backwards through the network and trace out the last layer. Then we add the first layer and apply as many perceptrons also in the back propagation way. But we stop before the unitary we want to update. And then we trace out everything which we don't need. And then we have the K matrix for updating this unitary. So as I said earlier, you can prove that this is the right form update the quantum perceptron. And I will not prove this here or derive this formula, but I still wanted to give you an overview how these update matrices look like. So now it's a good time to summarize the algorithm. So we started with training data, and then we had a QNN consisting of qubits and unitaries. And further, we had a training function. And based on this training loss, we update then the unitaries with the update rule. And after doing that a few times, so many times, we can test the network. And the best way to test a quantum neural network is to use unseen data. And therefore, we introduce a new loss, the validation loss. It is basically the same function as the first loss, the training loss, but it only uses unsupervised, it's only the unseen training pairs. So here we use for the training S training pairs, which are seen by the network during the training. And then we compute the training loss and update the K matrices and update our perceptrons. And the number of the supervised states is S. And on the other hand, we have the validation set, which is also built in the same way. We have input states and output states, but the network does not see this data during the training, so it's not trained using this data. And we use N minus S states. As in classical machine learning, we have a data set and then divided in training and validation sets. So we now know how to train and to test a quantum neural network. So it's time for some numerical results. And an easy example is the task of learning a unitary V. So we assume this uncharacterized or untrusted device we want to simulate is acting as a unitary on, for example, m qubit input states. And here you can see the validation cost, or loss function involving doing thousands of training steps using the explained algorithm. So on the x-axis, this is the step size. So we always have the s parameter during the training. And on the other axis, it's the unsupervised loss, the validation loss. And yeah, we always are interested in this loss, not in the training loss, because we want to see how well the quantum neural network generalizes. This means how well it performs on unseen data. And yeah, here in this example, we used 20 data pairs, 10 of them were supervised and the 10 remaining were for testing. We further used a 2-3-2 quantum neural network. And as you can see, we reach a fidelity of nearly 1, which is super good. So to study how well the quantum neural network is able to generalize, we can also vary the number of supervised states. And therefore, in the next plot, we only compare the end of the value, so only the last value of the loss function. So the last dot you can see here in the plot. And then we average over 10 individual training attempts for different number of s to get a more valid result. And here you can see an experiment where we had 10 training pairs and we changed the number s of supervised states. So this first dot here is the end of the validation loss function after training with only one training pair and testing on 99 and then so on. And we can see that the generalization works very well. So we only need like 6 training pairs out of the 100 pairs to get a validation loss over 0.95. So far we can be very happy. So the training works, the generalization works very well, but there's still a task open. Because all the training results I've shown so far were generated with using simulations running on classical computers. So this was a Python code we wrote to simulate the training. And then we had, of course, the question how the algorithm would perform on an actual quantum computer. And in the next minutes, I will give a very short overview of a possible implementation of the same algorithm on a quantum computer, more precisely on a NISQ device. And these noisy intermediate scale quantum devices are early quantum computers and mainly limited by two factors. First, they have a high noise level. And secondly, they only include small numbers of qubits. This means we have to lower our sights and cannot implement the algorithm exactly in the way explained in the last minutes. This part of the talk will be relying on a recent paper of us. In this work, we not only discussed the implementation in detail, but also compared the, in this talk, presented DQNN algorithm with the CoRoA, the the quantum approximate optimization algorithm. And as I already said, we implemented the algorithm on a NISQ device, by IBM. So as a scientist working in this field, it's kind of easy to get the permission to work with IBM. And the implementation and execution of the corresponding quantum circuits is carried out using an open source named Qiskit. And this is very comfortable for theorists as us, because we don't have to worry about the experiment. We just can upload code and let it run on a quantum computer, which is really cool, I think. To express the perceptron unitaries, we first remember that every 2-qubit unitary can be simulated, and more precisely, it can be the simulation can be done with using a 2-qubit canonical gate and 12 single-qubit gates. And hereby, the 2-qubit canonical gate is defined as a composition of 3 2-qubit gates, and using the Pauli matrices. And it's worth mentioning that all these three gates, the RxX and so on, are standard in quantum computing libraries, which is very practical. And the sequence of single qubit gates can be rephrased with the U gate, which is also a standard gate in most of the quantum computing libraries. So to summarize, we only need this CAN gate and the U gate and its corresponding suiting parameters to simulate a 2-qubit gate. But the quantum perceptron unitaries are not always 2-qubit unitaries. In general, they are, for example, here, the number of the first layer, 2, and then 1. So we have a 3-qubit unitary, and we have 3-qubit unitaries in the first layer, and then we have 2 4-qubit unitaries in the second layer. And these qubit unitaries connect the qubits from layer L minus 1 with 1 qubit from layer number L. So our motivation was then to replace one of these qubit unitaries with many of 2-qubit unitaries. So for example, the first unitary acting on 3 qubits is replaced by 2 2-qubit unitaries marked in dashed line and a dotted line. And numerical results later justify this idea. So what I meant was that we can replace the first layer by which was originally out of 3 3-qubit gates. We can replace it with 6 2-qubit unitaries. And see the dotted and the dashed line for an overview. And these are the CAN gates I mentioned before. To clarify the implementation of the quantum perceptron in the whole quantum neural network, we can build the neural network circuit layer-wise. So first of all, we have to initialize the input state and also initialize the other qubits in the zero state. So here we have a 2-3-2 neural network, and therefore, we need 7 qubits. And then the U gate is first applied to all the qubits in the first layer. Then we tensor it to the initialized second layer and apply the first layer of unitaries. And then we first apply the U gates to all the qubits in the layer, and then do the layer perceptrons. And at the end, there's an extra U, and then we remain with the output state because we traced out, as explained before in the algorithm, the layers we don't need anymore. As you may notice, so far we only described the process of processing the input state through the neural network becoming the output state. And this is only one component of the feed-forward part of the training algorithm. And yeah, we also need to train this DQNN. And therefore, yeah, we first have to make clear that we can describe all the gates with parameters. So we collect them, and the total number of parameters is omega n omega. And yeah, using these parameters, we can then discuss the learning aim. And as before, we have a set of states, of pairs of states, and we want to learn unknown m qubit unitary. So the circuit you see below should at the end simulate our desired unitary. We further use the same training loss, the fidelity. It's important to notice that then the output of the network depends on the parameters describing the quantum circuit. And in the classical simulation, the training took place by updating the entries of the unitaries, following an update rule, including an update matrix. And this update matrix was derived using the loss function. Here in the quantum computer realization, this is not possible in the moment. So yeah, we have to use the parameters and update the parameters of the gates. Therefore, we use gradient descent to find out how the parameters have to change to maximize the loss function. And so during the training, the gradient of the loss function with respect to the parameters is used to find the direction for each parameter that minimizes the loss function. Now we can collect all the parts together and have an overview about of all the procedure of the algorithm. So as a first step, we have to initialize the states and also load the training data. And then we can also decide on the step size and the learning rate, depending on the circumstances, and also the parameters of the gates are initialized randomly. In the second step, the DQNN quantum circuit is executed for all the states in the training set. So n qubits are initialized in the supervised state, and another n qubits are in random input state. And then after executing the DQNN quantum circuit, we trace out all the we trace out all the qubits we don't need and remain with the m qubits in the output state. And these m qubits can then be compared using the swap test and the fidelity. And then we can, due to these results, we can then update the circuit. And the swap test, which is used to execute the fidelity, consists of CNOT and swap gates. And using this destructive swap test is not only useful for calculating the training loss, but also the validation loss is calculated in the same way. Before plotting some results, we shortly have to mention a third loss function next to the training and validation cost. And this is the identity loss function. And this is worked out using the unitary identity and also the parameters of the network, which makes the network an identity. And assuming there would be no noise at all, this whole thing would act like the identity. But indeed, as you can see here, the gates, yeah, which are still applied, still add noise to the circuit, and hence this identity loss gives a good insight for the best possible training loss. So we can compare if our network algorithm works, or if it's only the noise, or it's a good thing to check. And based on this, we can then compare the training and validation cost. Here, the training of an exemplary DQNN, learning an unknown unitary is depicted. We used two networks, or a very small network, trained on the IBM M Casablanca with the 100 epochs and a learning rate of 1, and epsilon was 0.5. And we can understand from the plot that the training loss exceeds the identity loss after a few training epochs, and came to the result that the network is able to generalize the information provided to the training data despite the high noise level. In the paper I mentioned earlier, we also compared the Quora OA in the same setting, and we found that the DQNN for this learning task, for learning a unitary, gives a little bit better results. So I think I will end my talk with some graph structured data. So the last few minutes, I will present how to use graph structured quantum data as training data, because that's very interesting, I guess. And in the minutes before, we only used quantum data pairs, only the states, but now the training data pairs are associated with vertices of a graph. And further, we use the edges encoding correlations between the vertices during the training. So I will discuss this. But first, why is graph structured data interesting? So due to the fact that devices producing quantum data have structure itself, the resulting data will always be structured. So therefore, it is interesting to use this structure and algorithms. We are not the first ones who investigating using graph structure and algorithms, and but we are but our intention was to build the graph structure not into the neural network ansatz like in the ansatzes before, but we follow a different idea, and we want to make the QNN itself learn the graph structure on a quantum source. I will follow this notation and the examples of this paper. And so we want to start again with describing the data. The vertices of the graph correspond to the set of training data. And one vertex can be represented as a supervised training data pair or unsupervised validation pairs. The graph is not to be confused with the structure of the QNN, which consists of unitaries. And if the input states of the training pairs are two-qubit states, the first layer of the QNN has to be a two-qubit layer. So the output state should match the last layer of the QNN. So we have to think now about including the graph structure into the quantum data. And yeah, we can associate every graph with an adjacency matrix. The simplest form is where the edge is represented by one. And with this matrix and the Hilbert-Schmidt distance, we can build a new loss function, the graph information loss. So note that the Hilbert-Schmidt distance is small if two qubits you want to compare are not that different. So this means, the graph loss function is minimized when the output states of neighboring vertices in the graph are mapped close to the states. In contrast to the supervised loss, here the loss function go over all the training pairs and not only over the supervised ones. More precisely, we sum over combinations of all the V and W's, and we assume to have graph-related information about every training pair, and adjacency matrix turns off all the summons where the vertices are not directly connected to the graph. And it's important to notice this. Otherwise the loss function would to collapse into just one state. Okay, I guess the time is kind of fortgeschritten, how you call it. So I will quickly explain the learning. So we have still some supervised pairs marked in blue, and these states are included in the loss function we already know from the first part. And then we have the validation loss we also know, and then the third loss, the graph loss. So the training loss consists then of the supervised loss and the graph structure. So it uses the first set of data pairs and the graph structure with the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, and the validation, the testing loss only contains the second set of the data pairs. So I maybe skip this part here. So basically we have to use another update matrix, and as we saw before, the update matrix was defined by this commutator, and basically we can see that the update matrix for the graph loss is only propagating the difference between the input and propagating the difference between the output of the network. So we work with differences rather than with the input and supervised state here. Okay, but let's do some examples, or one example at least. We have here a graph with 11 edges, 8 vertices, 3 are supervised. And more precisely, we have here the states, the input states, which are random states, and the output states, here 0 and 1. And we build with these states this connected cluster. So we have here some states which are near the 0 state, and on the other hand, some states which are near the 1 state, and some state in the middle. And then we can compare the supervised supervised loss with the supervised plus graph loss. And here are not plotted the supervised or supervised plus graph loss, but the red curve is when training the neural network with using the graph information, so with using the information of the connected vertices, and the blue line is without using these connections. So in this special case where we had random input pairs and random input states, and this graph, this connected cluster output pairs, the graph information helps a lot. And we also did this for many supervised or for different number of S, and we can see that the graph structure really helps to learn the right states. So with this, I guess I wrap up my talk because it's kind of late. Today I talked about quantum machine learning and more precisely about supervised training of quantum neural networks. And we used quantum data pairs for the training and the validation of the QNN. Then I explained the architecture of the DQNN built of unitaries and connecting qubits. And we discussed how the network is updated and how the update matrices are built. And we saw some classical simulation of the training. Then further, I explained how to implement the DQNN and its algorithm, including the training loss and the parameters on a today available quantum computer. And additionally, a bit short and a bit quick, we learned how to use graph information to train the QNN and also saw some interesting results. So with that overview, I would like to thank you for this attention and sorry for taking so long. It was my pleasure.
No, thanks so much, Kirsten. That's a super nice, interesting talk. I liked your graphics. It was very clean. I'll repeat to everyone on the call, if you'd like to ask Kirsten a question, please drop a question in the Q&A function or in the chat, and we can promote you to a panelist or we can read out the question. I see that already we have a question here in the Q&A section from an anonymous attendee. And this person is writing, is the DQNN with fidelity equals one a copying device? That is, would it transform input states into a copy of states used for supervised learning? If it is a copying device, does it pose an inherent limit of accuracy on quantum neural networks? No cloning theorem.
So I think I did not get the question quite right. So the DQNN with fidelity one, so the DQNN has no fidelity. It's rather that we have the DQNN and then we can put new data in the network, and then we can calculate the fidelity cost function or validation function. And then this DQNN would be simulating the device where we got the training data. So think of a black box where you can put in some input state and then you get some output state. And basically a DQNN with fidelity which was tested to fidelity one would be a copy of the device. I don't know if this answers the question, but.
So if it doesn't answer the question, then we can ask the anonymous attendee to maybe write again or put your name in the chat, and then we could. But I think that's pretty clear. I had a question, but it's like a much more general kind of sweeping question, which is, Where do you kind of envision going with this? What type of problems do you think that this could be useful for, in the future? What are people going to do when we have a fully functioning quantum neural network?
Yeah. For example, like I said at the beginning, it is not possible to characterize quantum states. And if you, for example, want to characterize a special output of a device or something like that, you could apply a quantum neural network and then, instead of full tomography of complex quantum states, it would be easier to use quantum machine learning for these kind of things. And also, especially if we include also graph structure, we can add more information with different aspects of machine learning. For example, it's also possible to implement QGANs, so quantum generative adversarial networks, where we train a generator, and this is also something which might be interesting, to have a method to generate special quantum states. So yeah, you have a data set of quantum states with a special of a special kind, and you want more of these states, for example. This would be an idea.
Okay. Let's see. Can't see any more questions at the moment. Vlad is writing very nice talk and clear presentation. And applause, I agree. I have a slightly more technical question as well, and I think you kind of touched upon it. So I apologize if the answer was clearly presented. But so, you know, in terms of these like big V unitaries that you put in here, like, you know, if they belong to some Hilbert space of a certain dimension, how does, well, I guess it's two questions really, or maybe three. So how does the kind of, you know, the effectiveness of these deep quantum neural networks scale with the Hilbert space dimension? How much harder does the training get? And do you have any idea of how the kind of noise robustness scale with the Hilbert space dimension in these?
So far, so far, unfortunately, due to the limited, number of qubits we have in the NISQ devices, we could not test like really big quantum neural networks, or also not very deep quantum neural networks. So we cannot really say anything about that now. But in the at least in the numerical results, the numerical simulation in Python, without the noise which a NISQ device usually produces, we had kind of good results. And also with higher, for example, 4-qubit states, we tested and had good training results, also leading to fidelity nearly 1. So I cannot say something about like much more qubits due to the state of the quantum computers in the moment, and also the limited classical simulation possibilities we have.
But are you you're hopeful? It sounds like you're hopeful, kind of.
Yeah, I am hopeful.
Okay. Any more questions? I think this is the last chance. And I know, Kirsten, you kind of had to pop out in just in a second. So
yeah, if there are some more questions, please write me an email, or if you have questions to the papers, we are welcome to have more discussions in our group.
Thanks. I think actually with that, it's time to thank you once again to coming to give this talk. This was great. Thank you very much.